Hey, welcome to Five a Night. My name is Blaine Bartell. It's good to have you with us on the program this month. This month, we're going to feature an excellent contemporary Christian artist, Kim Boyce. She was one of the top 10 finalists for Miss America back in 1983, has a tremendous testimony, tremendous ministry. We're going to be talking on the program on the topic, how to raise your parents. That's incredible, how to raise your parents. You're going to like this. And, you know, I believe that Jesus can bridge the generation gap that we've seen form in the last few years between parents and teenagers, and in a good way. It's going to be a good program. Stick around.
Son, would you please turn that junk down? We can't even hear ourselves think in this house.
Have you even studied for your finals yet?
No, I haven't had the time. I just got this new...
I am sick and tired of your excuses. All you care about is that garbage music. Now, you know that stuff's no good for you. Now, I want you to get that stuff out of this house today, and you start accepting some responsibility around here. Now, get with it.
Me get with it? I wish they would get with it. I wish they'd get off my case, too. I'm always having to do what they say. They're so intense. What's wrong with my music, anyway? Maybe if they were more like me, life would be a whole lot easier.
Check it out! Hey, Dad, aren't you going to work today?
Hey, dude, what it is, man? Rocking out, huh? Nah, man, I just got Twisted Blister's new album, and I want to learn all the new bass parts, man.
Okay. Hey, Mom, what's for breakfast?
Whatever you can find, honcho.
Yeah, sure, Mom. Mom, aren't you gonna get my graduation outfit today?
No, man, no can do. I sold the car and bought a new set of drums. They're awesome.
But, what about graduation tonight?
Oh, yeah, man. Sorry, we can't do it. Man, we're gonna go cruising tonight, and then we're going to the Iron Roden concert. Sorry, dude, just can't do it.
Oh. But Mom, Dad,
sorry,
Mom,
dude.
Dad, Mom, Dad, you can't do this
sorry,
to me.
Dude.
You can't do this. Mom, Dad, don't do this. Dad, you can't do this to me.
Dad, no.
Mom, Dad.
Are you okay? It looked like you were having a bad dream.
No, no big deal.
Son, we're going to be going out for a couple hours this evening. Are you going to be all right?
Sure, Dad. Where are you guys going?
Oh, we're just going to go downtown and see the Stones at their big concert.
The Stones? The Stones? Oh, no! Please don't go. You don't belong there. They'll corrupt you and cause you to get in a lot of trouble. If you don't go, I won't listen to any more of that music. And I'll even study hard.
I don't know what you're talking about, but that sounds great. We're just going to go meet Fred Mildred Stone at their choir concert tonight. Would you like to go?
No, Dad. That's great. I'm really glad that you guys are going to that tonight. I think I'll stay here and hit the books, clean up my room, tidy up a little bit. Have a wonderful time.
Special guest this program is a young lady that has made a tremendous splash in the last few years in the Christian music scene. Her name is Kim Boyce. So Kim, it's good to have you on the program.
Thanks, Brian. Good to be here.
You have a unique history that not many people have. You were voted, I guess, or whatever, crowned Miss Florida back in 1983, and then one of the top 10 finalists in Miss America.
Mm-hmm.
Not many ladies have had that kind of thing, you know, happen to them. Tell us what that was like for you being a Christian.
It was a great experience overall. It really was, and it certainly trained me in a lot of ways to do what I'm doing now. I was on the road about 300 days out of that 365-day period, and so I learned a lot of PR techniques and things like that that I'm having to use now, how to live on the road, things like that. So it was really good experience for me, and I wouldn't trade it for anything. And as a Christian, it was no problem at all. A lot of the girls in the pageants were Christian girls, because the Miss America system being sort of like the girl next door type pageant that attracts the Christian girls. And plus, a lot of us have had an opportunity through the years in church to practice our talent, and talent's 50% of the pageant, so that helps too.
Yeah. Now, coming out of that, you kind of went into the Christian music scene and got involved in that. Tell us about the beginnings and bring us up to now.
Well, let's see. I gave up my title as Miss Florida. My year ended in June of 1984. And after that, I spent about 6 or 7 months down in Florida trying to figure out exactly what to do, because I knew God had called me to do Christian music, but I just didn't quite know how I would get into it. And through a series of events, I ended up moving to Nashville. I had gotten together with a man who has since been my manager for these last 3 years, and he's really been a blessing in my life. And I moved to Nashville, did a demo tape of 3 songs, and he took that tape around to a bunch of different record companies, and most of them said, no, forget this girl, she was a beauty queen, she's a has-been, just get her out of here. But one record company really believed in me, and that was Word, and particularly the Myrrh label, who I'm signed with now. And I signed with them the very last of 1985 and spent most of 86 in the studio working on the album, writing, and then having it produced and things like that. And then I went out for the first time in the fall of 86 with Greg Vols on a tour, and I have been touring consistently ever since then.
Obviously, you like it. I mean, I asked you earlier, and you said you were gone, like, I said, how many days out of the month are you gone? You said 30,
yeah.
So you must enjoy ministering to young people.
I really do.
That's great. We're going to look at a song that's on your latest album, and it's called Love Resurrection. Excellent song. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that as we look at it?
This song is sort of my tribute, I guess I should say, to say, listen, Christians, let's get together and show the world that we are Christians by our love and have a love resurrection.
parents, do you find your teenagers saying things like this to you?
Hey, I don't feel like it. I'm busy right now. Can't you see I'm on the phone? I'll get to it later. I wish you'd quit bugging me about it.
Now you can put an end to the unruliness with the Spare the Rod, but not the Voltage Obedient Zapper, as seen on radios everywhere. This lightweight electrical device straps onto any child's ankle with ease and with no discomfort. The remote control unit is operated by any garage door opener and administers a powerful yet safe electrical shock. Here's how it works.
Listen, don't even think about leaving this table until you finish every last one of those vegetables.
Look, Mom, I told you, I don't want to eat them. I hate vegetables.
Now, eliminate all excuses when it comes to cleaning up the room.
Look, I told you to clean this room up.
But, Mom, this way I know where everything is.
No more excuses, Johnny. Do it now.
Mom, I don't want to.
This is gonna hurt you more than it does me.
If within 30 days you're not totally satisfied, please return for a full refund. The Spare the Rod, but not the Voltage Obedient Zapper, comes with batteries and remote control included.
Johnny, I think the lawn could use mowing today.
But Mom, it's not lawn.
Johnny.
Okay, Mom.
To order, rush 1995 to Long Life on the Earth Incorporated, P.O. Box 12. That's all the address you need, because he who loves his child disciplines him promptly.
Well, aren't you glad that device isn't on the market? Some of your parents might just pick it up. You know, the Bible says in the book of Proverbs 14:34 that righteousness exalts a nation. That has a lot to say when we talk about how to raise your parents. Because if righteousness exalts a nation, then it can also exalt your parents. And that word exalt means to raise up. So if you're righteous and right with God and doing the right things for God, you're going to raise your parents. Now I want to give you some clues on how to raise your parents right. Number one, pray for your parents. Some of you have parents that maybe do things that get you upset. Maybe even they abuse you or do things that aren't right, really. And you wonder, what should I do? Should I just get bitter, get mad? Should I tell them the way I think? Listen, the Bible says to pray for those that despitefully use you. Bless those who curse you. So extend the love of God through prayer for your parents, and you'll see God change their life. Also, the second thing, use wisdom and be wise in your decisions. Don't just make decisions that are based on your feelings or based on the spur of the moment. Always think about what you're doing. A wise son, it says in Proverbs, makes his father glad. You'll have a joyful, happy home if you're wise and smart in the decisions you make. And then thirdly, love correction. Proverbs 15:10 says, if you hate reproof, you'll die. You will suffer destruction and eventually death, both spiritual and natural, if you hate reproof. Love correction. Don't be afraid when someone tells you what to do, especially your parents, because the Bible says, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. And God will give you a long life and a good life if you'll do that. So those are some important tips to remember on how to raise your parents.
Hello and welcome to Nifty New and Used Parent Dealership, where we've got the parents to fit your lifestyle.
Yeah, I was wondering what kind of price I could get for my parents on a trade-in.
Well, let's see. They seem to be in very good condition. I like that upholstery and I love those tinted windows. Could you smile for me, please? Ooh, no rust. That's great. Let me ask you, are they high mileage?
No, Dad's 39 and Mom's 36.
Great. One other question, if I may. Is there anything wrong with them?
No, nothing's wrong. I was just looking for a model with a little more room, you know, space. Ones that won't hassle me and let me do what I want. I mean, this couple makes me be in by 10 o'clock and go to church every single Sunday. They cramp my style.
I understand completely. You want a couple that can handle life in the sporty, fast lane.
Yeah, exactly.
We've got just the couple for you. Turn around and let me introduce you to Dr. and Mrs. W. Plentybucks. Mr. Plentybucks is the president of Mega Moolah Bank. Mrs. Plentybucks is very, very successful and rich in her own right, which means that in this package, you are going to receive Visa, MasterCard, and American Express with unlimited spending on all of them. Now, they do have an 11 o'clock curfew, you know, but just between you and me, they're never really around to enforce it. Now, this is a one-owner couple. I'll tell you what, they'll let you have the run of the road.
But what happened to the last owner?
Nothing at all.
Tell me.
Well, he got to hanging around with the wrong crowd, and his parents never really knew about it, and his gang came in to rob the bank, and his father shot him.
I don't know.
Wait a minute. No. This is a repossession model. I'm telling you, we can work out some tremendous financing. I'll tell you what, if you'll buy today, I'll even throw in a bulletproof vest. They look great and they travel really easy.
No, I don't think so.
Okay, well, wait a minute. Do you realize we are talking private school here?
Let's take a look at something else.
Okay, let's see. No, not liberal. Ah! Just the couple. This is our unlimited mileage model, and I want to tell you something on this model. No speed limit.
Do you mind if I test drive them?
Oh, no, please go right ahead.
Okay, Dad. Let's say I've got finals on Monday, but instead of studying, I went to a slumber party with a bunch of girls you don't even know, and I forgot to ask. What would you say?
That's fine, dear. Want a beer?
Oh, that's good. Okay. Now, the laundry hasn't been done in weeks. The dirty dishes are piled to the ceiling. My room is a total mess. I haven't made my bed in over a week, and I ask you to make me dinner while I watch TV. What would you say?
Whatever your father says, dear.
Sure, have a beer.
Great, these are exactly what I've been looking for. How much are they?
They're only $30,000, and with your parents in trade, we can let you have them for $27,900. Now, that includes tags and taxes. Oh, and I do have another young man looking at this couple right now. As a matter of fact, he said he'd be calling back this afternoon to let me know, you know, his decision. I would suggest you buy now.
This couple must make much more money than the Plenty Bucks model.
Well, no, as a matter of fact, right now they're unemployed. However, they do always manage to scrape up enough nickels for beer.
I see. One more question.
Certainly.
This couple is used, correct?
Yes, they are. Tell you what, why don't we step over to my desk and start filling out that credit application?
Oh, wait a minute. Where can I get a hold of the last owner? Just for verification?
Well, where she's at, she can't receive phone calls or have any visitors.
Well, where's that?
Well, it's a juvenile alcoholic ward upstate somewhere. Not important at all.
I'll take these. You know, I have shopped this whole city looking for a set like this. They're stable on the road. Good Christian standards. But most of all, they really care. I don't care how much they cost, I want them.
Okay, you've made a great choice. We just got them in today. These kind of parents are rare. We hardly ever get them. As a matter of fact, I've got a whole warehouse and a showroom stacked full of those uncaring, compromising, secular humanist models. If you ask me, the kid that gave these parents up must have been crazy.
Hey, wait a minute. They're not for sale. I haven't signed any papers yet, and I think I'm going to reconsider trading these in. After all, there's a lot of good mileage left on them. Come on, Mom and Dad, let's go home.
Man, I hate to lose a set like that. She has no idea how few parents like that are left in the world. Classics, you know what I mean?
Have a beer.
Hot. I'm Ron Luce, and we're going to see what's hot in today's Christian music. Steve Taylor has finally released his new album titled I Predict 1990. Sounds like Taylor, doesn't it? This album's more progressive, not just another repeat of his old music. DeGarmo and Key, along with the Benson Company, are giving away over $1 million worth of music. The October release, D&K, has seen the largest pre-sales in the group's 10-year history and exceeds 100,000 units, making this million-dollar music giveaway possible. D&K is packaged in a special two-cassette long box, retailing at $9.98, and marked prominently on the cover, contains two cassettes. Give one away to someone who needs to hear. Eddie and Dana explain, we play to hundreds of thousands of people every year. It's obvious that the vast majority of people who really need to hear the message of hope that Jesus offers will probably never buy our recordings or attend our concerts. This duo's unprecedented effort encourages you to use a second cassette as a tool for evangelism. D&K is a hot-sounding album, something you'll be proud to give to your friends. Just listen to the single, Out of the Danger Zone, which is number one this month on our Five by Night Top 10 Countdown. Hey, hey, Sounds like secular rock and roll has become an overt part of separating teens from their parents. Kids come home from concerts wanting to do more of what the rock star says than their own parents. At a recent Kiss concert, Gene Simmons yelled, "How many of your parents didn't want you to come tonight?" And then he yelled, "How many of you don't care what your parents think?" And the crowd roared with rebellion. Dee Snider of Twisted Sister recently said, "The way we look is every parent's nightmare." So I guess we are standing up for kids against their parents. That comes across in the video as well as in the music. Jesus is in the business of keeping families together. I hope you're smart enough to stay away from these secular rock influences that would want to tear your family apart. Well, I'm Ron Luce, and that's what's hot. We'll see you next month.
With Kim Boyce, and Kim, we're talking this month on the program about parent-teen relationships. Mm-hmm. What kind of home life did you have growing up as a teenager?
I was very blessed to be born into a Christian family. I think my family, as long as I can even remember generations back, has always been Christians. And so because of that, I think I had a very minimally turbulent teenage years. And that's not to say that I don't think that I learned some things. We had trouble in our home, just like any other family would. My mom used to threaten to just wash my mouth out with soap every other day because I had such a smart aleck mouth, you know, and those kind of things. But it's since I've been away from home that I've really learned how good I had it at home. And then as I'm out ministering to young people who have very bad home situations, I've learned so much about those places that kids can end up, that the Lord has really placed a real burden on my heart for home situations. And then, you know, I even talked to some young parents who are having trouble with their kids, you know, as the reverse of this, and they just, you know, say, "What in the world am I going to do?" And all I can say is that the thing that I know more than anything else that I found out in my life and that I've seen happen in other people's lives is that Jesus is the only hope. He's our only answer, and we have to turn our lives over to Him and just believe in faith that He's going to be able to handle whatever type of a problem we may find ourselves in our lifetime.
Growing up in a Christian home, was there ever a time in your life where you just thought, you know, I'm going to kind of spread my wings a little bit and kind of do my own thing here? I don't know if my parents' faith is really my faith. Did you ever have a rebellious time?
Yeah, I did. And I really came to a point just a few years ago where I had to find out if this stuff was going to work. I had been in the family forever and ever, and when I moved away from home, I just had to say, okay, is this really going to work or is it not? And I had already moved to Nashville to do Christian music, and all of a sudden I found myself in a little tiny apartment crying, laying in the floor going, "God, what in the world am I doing here? Where are you when I need you?" But I have found out that Jesus can be that friend that sticks closer than a brother. And I think that it took me getting actually away from home to have to find out that, yeah, this faith is going to work. And my encouragement to kids who are in a bad home situation is, don't wait till you have to leave. Don't try to run away to get away from it. Make that faith happen for you right there where you are.
Yeah. I think the biggest struggle with teenagers and parents is that they get in a situation where the parents ask them a certain thing, you know, to be home by this time,
right,
or to do this or do that. And the teenager, and I remember this, you think you know a better time.
Everything.
Or a better idea.
That's right.
Did you ever have a thing that you
yeah.
can remember like that with your parents?
Oh.
And how would we deal with that as teenagers?
Well, my big problem was we went to school about 15 miles away from home, and my sisters and I would pile in the car. I was the oldest, so I was driving, and it was always my responsibility to get everybody home on time. Well, we didn't always make it, and then we'd be in big trouble, but Dad would say, "Kim, just call me. That's all. I'm just worried about where you are. If you'll just call and say you're going to be late, you'll be fine." And I think it's just a matter of understanding a lot of times that parents aren't out there just to get us. They're concerned about our safety and our well-being, and that's why they impose these things on us that we think we know better, when really they've been there before, and I think that's why they get a little scared sometimes for us.
Yeah. Do you ever, in your concerts, come across kids that maybe come from broken homes? I can relate to you. I come from a good family, and, man, my parents were just great and got along as a family. But But sometimes it's hard for me to relate to someone who comes from a busted home. What do you tell kids like that when you meet them and they share that problem in their life?
I think now, being out on my own and single, I have experienced more of the loneliness that somebody in a broken home must feel than I did ever at home. But I've counseled with a girl now for 3 years who came from a terrible, terrible home situation. And I've watched what the Lord has done in her life, and I've seen the heartache and the bitterness and the anger that was left in her heart from a terrible home situation, even after being a Christian for a couple of years now. And I just see what that can do to somebody, and really the miracle that it takes for someone to come out of a situation like that and to be a whole, well person can only come from the Lord. I know that, and I've watched this girl struggle, and I've watched her grow in spite of everything in the world being against her. And so I know it works for her, and it can work for all of us.
On our last Family First.
It's cool.
Everybody get down on the floor. Open that register, man. Open it. I said get down, man. Done. Get down.
What happened to him? Okay, down. Put him over into triage. Put a few large bore IVs.
We got a lot of crazy things to do yet. Hey, we prayed for you, man. God's gonna raise you up.
Hey, what's going on? Clarence, come out of it?
No, Doug, you can't go in there. He's starting to hemorrhage. We have to rush him back to surgery.
No, Dad, I believe God healed Clarence, but it's been 2 weeks now since he got out of surgery, and he's still in a coma. How long is it going to take?
Son, we believe God heard us when we prayed. We know he's at work even though we can't see anything. The Bible says when you've done all to stand, to just keep on standing.
Well, if we really believe he's healed, we need to just thank God for his recovery.
Well, let's just do that right now. Father, we just thank you that your word is true. And even though we haven't seen any evidence of it, we know that you're at work here, Father. And we just lift our hands and thank you that Clarence is recovering according to your word. By Jesus' stripes, he was healed. And we give you praise for it in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord, in Jesus' name. Thank you for quickening his mortal body. In Jesus' mighty name, glory to God. Hallelujah.
Well, listen, guys, we better get out of here. Visiting hours are just about over. I wanted to go up and see Clarence's parents before we left.
Hey, bud, we're going to be playing frisbee football in no time.
I hate that game.
What? He's back.
Well, Doug, you know what they say. It ain't over till the fat angel sings.
How's it feel to be on your feet again and out of bed?
Great. And for the last few weeks, I've had plenty of time to do a lot of thinking and praying. You know, Doug, when death has you in its cold, dark grip, and only by a miracle you escape into the dawn, you know God has a special purpose in your life. And I know what mine is.
Great. What has God told you to do?
Join a rock band.
Praise the Lord, Clarence. You sure you haven't been reading Rolling Stone magazine the last few weeks?
No, I'm serious, Doug. There are millions, perhaps tens of thousands of people that have had that same brush with death, just as I did. And they don't know about Jesus. You know what? They all listen to rock music.
Yeah, they do, but they all don't listen to Christian rock music.
That's right. That's why God has opened the door for me to join a secular rock band.
What?
What in the world is that?
Hey, there's no skateboarding in this house. Where did you get that thing?
Pretty rad, huh? This is Tommy's board. Check out these Sims wheels.
Look, Robert, if Tommy ever wants to see a skateboard again, I highly recommend you do the rest of your boarding out of doors.
Recommendation received and acknowledged. Oh, by the way, there's this really hot skateboarding team doing an exhibition down at the mall parking lot this Friday night. They're setting up these really rad ramps and bowls and jumps. You think I can go?
Friday night, you say? No, Robert, you can't go. I'm sorry.
Come on, Dad, why not?
Robert, he said you can't go. That should be reason enough.
But...
No buts about it, young man. You just can't go.
Clarence, how on earth do you think you're going to win anyone to Jesus singing in a secular rock band?
Here's the plan, Doug. First, we're going to start out real low-key. In other words, we're not going to mention anything about Jesus. And then, when we're too famous to ignore, we'll boldly proclaim our faith for all the world to hear.
I don't know. What band is this, anyways?
It's a new band in Chicago called the Spasmatics. And they want me, Clarence E. Stanley, to be the new lead singer.
Have they booked any gigs yet?
No, they don't dance. They're a band. They sing.
Clarence, I didn't say jigs. I said gigs. Concerts.
Well, no. They don't have a lead singer yet. Or a PA system. But I'm more than happy to provide the money for it.
How much is this going to cost you?
Doug, I'm so committed to this call that God's put on my life that I'm going to invest my entire life savings into this.
Well, you sure they got change for a dollar?
No, I'm investing all of $679.83.
My goodness, are you sure your parents are going to go for this?
Absolutely.
Absolutely not. You are not joining some whirly rock and roll band, and you are certainly not spending your life savings to buy them a loudspeaker.
That's right, Clarence. You know we do not approve of secular rock and roll, and I don't think the Lord does either. Besides, you've been saving that money to buy a new car or college, your future.
But, Mom, this is my future. I'm going to be just like you two.
Oh, Clarence, that's so flattering. You want to be like us, too. But we don't want to play in a rock and roll band.
No. You two is a rock and roll band.
No, we're not. We are your parents, and I'm telling you, this is out of the question.
Look, I'm really sorry you guys don't have the same vision that I do about reaching the world for Jesus, but I've got to go on and do what God's told me to.
If you know what's good for you, you'll obey your parents.
Yeah, Clarence. Mom and Dad always knows it's right.
I can't believe you guys.
Ho, guys, ho.
Hey, fellow rock and rollers. I'm sorry I'm late, but I had to talk over a few details with Mom and Dad.
Mom and Dad? How's the old man anyway?
But the old man, why, he's dead.
Dead?
Yes, sir. He's been crucified with Christ. No longer I that lives, but Christ that lives within me.
Yeah, but remember, we want to keep that stuff real low-key, okay?
Oh, sure, you bet. Hey, I learned all the lyrics to the very first song.
Oh, that's great. But it isn't going to do us any good unless we have a PA. Did you bring some money?
Yeah, I brought all $679.83.
I tell you what, you just keep the change.
Thanks. Did everybody else bring their money?
Oh, yeah. We brought ours, didn't we, guys?
Great.
But your contribution made all the difference in the world.
Well, praise the Lord. I'm just sowing good seed in good ground.
The Lord
we thank you for blessing this food and for providing these plastic cups and plates, because all the others are in the dishwasher. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Just kidding.
Well, praise God for the Colonel. Mommy's come through again, hasn't he?
Hey, you know what? We get to learn how to play badminton tomorrow in gym class.
Connie, you obviously have no idea what the object of that game is.
Well, it's just like tennis, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, just like tennis. I mean, except for the fact that they don't use balls, do they, Dan? They use little birdies. Defenseless little birdies.
Dad, that's not true.
Oh, yeah, I'm afraid so, honey. Two players hit this little birdie back and forth and back and forth until it either gets stuck in the net or goes smashing down on the ground.
Well, that's sick.
It sure is, guys.
Hey, Dad, I know why you won't let me go to that skateboard exhibition. It's because you thought I'd be out past my curfew. Well, I won't. It gets over at 8:30. So can I go?
No. Pass the smashed potatoes, please.
I know what it was. You thought I didn't have the money to get in. Well, listen, it won't cost you a penny. I've got $10 saved up.
Oh, well, that's great. I'm really proud of you, Robert.
Great. Then I can go?
No.
Dad, did I ever apologize for riding my skateboard in the house the other day?
No, you didn't, but apology accepted.
Great. Then I can go?
I'm sorry, son.
But why?
Come in, Clarence.
Hey, how's the Collins clan? Y'all aren't eating dinner, are you?
What tipped y'all, Clarence?
Oh, I don't know.
Hey, how's the founder of Rock and Roll Ministries doing, Clarence?
Awesome, Doug. We've already got our first three songs down, a new PA system, we're looking at a laser light show, and our agent, he's almost booked our very first concert. That's nothing compared to this. I talked to Michael Jackson's producer, Quincy Jones, about doing an album for us.
You talked to Michael Jackson's producer?
Well, I talked to his answering machine, and it seemed real open.
Hey, Clarence, now, what do your parents think about this deal?
Well, they haven't quite received complete revelation knowledge on the vision God's given me. But I'm not going to let that stop me from fulfilling my heavenly calling.
In other words, your parents says no, but you're going to disobey and do it anyway, right?
Well, I never quite looked at it that way.
You know, Dad's always had a way of cutting through the crud.
Well, honey, we received three more appointment cards from the optometrist today.
Well, you know, honey, eye health is so important to us. E-E-R-T. You'd think I'd have this memorized by now. Clarence, are you going out again tonight?
Yeah, Dad. See y'all later.
Well, Clarence. This is five times this week, son. How about a little family time? How about a game of Twister?
No, Dad, I really couldn't play Twister. My back from the surgery.
Well, what are you going to do tonight, dear?
Well, Doug and I, we're going to go to the YMCA for my back therapy. I'm doing a lot better. Well, I'm going to go pick up Doug. See you later.
Bye, son.
Hello?
Oh, hi, Doug. No, he just left. He said he was on the way over to your house. He said you were going to the Y tonight. Just a minute, Doug.
Look, Clarence has closed his bank account. He took out all the money!
Doug, do you know the address where that band is rehearsing tonight? Come on, Doug. You're his best friend, but I'm his father. I want that address.
Guys, I'm telling you, you ought to see this chick. I'm talking out of sight. There's the number. I promise you, Foxy Lady.
Hey, guys, y'all ready for a real good practice?
Yeah, we'll get to it.
How's this sound? How about if we had a word of prayer first?
Clarence, we already took care of that. Let's just get to it.
Okay, ready, guys? One, two, three.
Clarence, you're at least three keys off on that.
Well, these guys were so loud, I could hardly think to hear myself.
You mean hear yourself think?
Yeah, that too.
Excuse me, y'all the spasmatics?
Wrong address, man, down the road.
No, yeah, we're the Spasmatics. Are you Quincy Jones, the record producer?
No, I'm Harry Jones, the repossessor. And you haven't made one single payment on this PA system, and that's a major no-no.
Wait a minute, we paid cash for that system. Show him the receipt, Randy.
Listen, man, it's not easy to manage a band like this. We've got expenses. Check out these clothes. Bad, huh? Then we've got refreshments, guitar picks, gas for my Camaro, dates with Sheila, gas for Bob's Camaro. Anyway, man, the list goes on and on. But guess what? Your PA didn't make the list.
Great. What are we supposed to do now? We don't have a PA system.
Hey, guys, can you help me with some of this stuff?
Who's he?
Well, Clarence, he's the new lead singer. He's got his own PA equipment.
Oh, we got two lead singers now, huh?
No, Stanley, we've made adjustments. You're out.
Okay, fine. I just want my money back, okay?
Money? What money?
I thought you were going to be in therapy tonight, Clarence.
Dad, this is therapy. Okay, everybody, and one, two...
Listen to me, young man. You just had to have it your way, didn't you? You've gone behind our backs, and you've done this against our advice. No, against our orders. Now you're going to have to pay the price. You're in big trouble.
Hey, Stanley, you should listen to your old man. He's not so dumb.
Dad, look, I'm sorry. I made a mistake, but I'll make it up to you, I promise.
You bet you will. Come on, we're going now.
Thanks a lot, guys. I thought you were my friends.
Are you sure they won't let you go tonight? Maybe you could ask them one more time, and if they still said no, I mean, you could always sneak out with us.
No way, Tommy. I don't know why they don't want me to go, but I'm not gonna fight it. In the words of my father, it doesn't pay to disobey.
Man, your parents are tough as nails. Well, I'll catch you later.
Happy birthday, Robert!
Happy birthday, son.
Well, my birthday's not till Sunday.
We're going to celebrate tonight. We got all your friends together, going to have some cake, a little bit of ice cream, might even play some pin the tail on the donkey.
Oh, sick. Yes, sir.
Kid stuff.
Well, I do have those tickets that the paper gave me for that skateboard exhibition, front row seats, but you guys wouldn't want to go to that one. Here's a present from your mom and I.
Oh, nice!
Awesome!
You like it? Huh? You like it?
I want to talk to you for a minute about the five cries of parents in the 80s. And each one of these cries represents an area of discipline and obedience that it is imperative for us to develop. It says in Ephesians 6:1, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and thy mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may be well with thee and thou mayest live long on the earth. It's a command for us to walk in obedience and submission to our parents. And the five cries of parents are this. Number one, I'm tired of you watching that idiot box television. I'm sure every one of us have heard that at one time or another. And that is a cry for a discipline in our time. There's many of us that the devil's been trying to destroy our time and trying to take away our time, trying to get us to waste our time. And I encourage you to discipline yourself in that area. There's nothing wrong with watching television from time to time, but don't allow yourself to be absolutely taken over to where that's all you do is sit in front of the TV all the time. You can be more creative than that. And also in curfews. You know, I don't know of probably any teenager that likes any curfew. It doesn't matter if it's 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 12:30. I think everyone, will complain no matter what the curfew is. So just be willing to submit to it. Be willing to understand that it's there for a reason. It's going to help you. It's going to keep you out of problems. And obey your parents because it'll be well with these. So that's very important. Number two, this is another cry. You want to buy what? Do you know how much that costs? That is a cry for discipline in our money, in our spending. And I know as teenagers, there's so many things we want to buy. There's a million things we want to buy. Everything is out there, and our friend gets something, we want to have it, and that's natural. But discipline yourself in your spending. One important thing is don't buy on impulse. Some of you are getting to the place where you want maybe to buy a car. I remember when I first began to look for a car, the first car I saw, man, I wanted to buy it. I was ready to put my money down and buy it and go home with it. And I'm so glad that my father was there to help me in that area, because if I would have, it would have been a lemon. I mean, the thing had all kinds of problems, but I didn't see him at the time. And your parents can be a real help in that, not to buy on impulse, things like that. Also in your money, learn to earn money. Find jobs that you can do to be a blessing so that you can bring some of your own money in. And also be a tither. Be a giver. What God gives you, make sure and give a tenth back to Him, back to the church, back to your youth group in giving and tithing. And the Lord will be able to bless you with more. So be disciplined in your money. The next cry of parents is, look at all the D's on this report card. That is a cry for discipline in your school. And school is very important. I want to tell you that the people out there who have good jobs, who are doing well as adults, are people who got a good education and got past their high school and went on to get involved in college or university. And so it's important that you really take time to study and do well in your school. Don't slack off in that area. Attend your classes. Don't skip out all the time like that, because then God can't bless you and you won't be blessed in the future. So remember, this is a time of preparation for you in your school. Next thing, four, don't talk to me like that. That is a cry for discipline in your attitude and in respect. Show honor and show respect for your parents. Don't always be talking back to them. There's nothing wrong with talking to them about something, but don't be sarcastic and talk back all the time. That'll just hurt you. It says in Isaiah 1:19, those that are willing and obedient. Don't just be obedient, walk off, okay, I'll do it. If you want me to do it, I'll do it. Fine, I'll do it. Be willing and obedient, and God says He'll bless you if you do both of those, not just obedience. The fifth and last thing is clean the room, take out the garbage, do the lawn, do the dishes, mow the lawn. And that's a cry for discipline and work. Do your jobs around the house. Don't be someone who slacks off. And also, don't procrastinate. I think eventually we all do our jobs, but sometimes it's like, yeah, as soon as I finish this, as soon as I finish that, and it never gets done, and it becomes a real source of irritation. So be disciplined in those five areas, and I guarantee you'll have tremendous relationship in your home with your parents. Let's pray as we close. Father, we ask You right now to help us in our homes. Father, we know that revival, that Your Spirit begins to move in our homes across America, and we ask You that we can be a part of that. Lord, that You would help us to get along with our parents, help us to be a blessing to them. Father, if we've been hurt, we pray for them right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank You, Lord. We give You glory. There's some teenagers that are watching, and the Spirit of God told me that you've been abused. You've been hurt by your parents physically, even some maybe sexually. And right now, the Spirit of God is healing those broken hearts. The Bible says that He's come to heal the brokenhearted. And in Jesus' name, I release healing to you. That heart that's been broken and that pain that you suffered because of that abuse is broken right now in the name of Jesus. And I break the power of that spirit over your parents that has caused that to happen. I bind that and command you, devil, to take your hands off of those parents in Jesus' name. And Father, I thank you as we show love to those parents, that you will surround them with love and with your acceptance. And God, that thing will be changed, because love covers a multitude of sin. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for tremendous relationships to be developed between us and our parents. I ask you to bridge the generation gap. Lord, that we would be brought together in your love, that we might be a powerful force as a family for God in Jesus' name. And we thank you that you're always here, Lord. You're always with us. You never leave us or forsake us. You'll help us in every problem. And for that, we give you glory and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, time goes by so quick. That's another program. We want to thank Kim Boyce for being with us. And don't forget, next month we've got Rob Frazier. We're going to be talking about how to be really committed to the Lord. It's going to be really fun. See you next time.